Thank you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
Imagine you only have 1 week left to live. What would you do? Jesus is in no rush to go and raise Lazarus from the dead. In fact, the longer he's dead, the greater the miracle's going to be. We're here to make the most of every opportunity to worship and serve God, placing value in him and on him. We don't need a Palm Sunday to celebrate Jesus, because we know that knowing him transforms life into something beautiful, where we can live prosperous and where we can live victorious. In the words of an old American friend of ours, we are living on the victory side, brother. So we're talking about Holy Tuesday. We've had Holy Monday. We've now got Horrible Tuesday. It's Holy Tuesday. Now that he's got their attention, he figures he'll teach them a thing or two. But inevitably, he's made some enemies. Well, no surprises there. And they decide that they're going to teach him a thing or two. And so they question his authority by effectively saying, "Who do you think you are, you good-for-nothing so-and-so?" He answers them like only Jesus can, by asking a question. And since they can't answer his question, he decides he won't answer theirs. Sure there's something that we need to learn from that. Jesus used this day not only to teach them truth, but show them wisdom. Jesus was smart. We forget that sometimes. We don't give him credit for just how smart he really was. He thought on his feet. In this conversation, this dialogue, he covered taxes to Caesar. He covered the resurrection. He covered the greatest commandment. He covered the importance of giving, using the illustration of the widow's mite. That was right there on this day, Holy Tuesday. Later on that day, when he was done, he moved across the road to the Mount of Olives, where he sat teaching his disciples more truth, in particular, his return, the second coming. So just a few thoughts before we go on to Wednesday. You'll never believe what Wednesday's called. Does it cross your mind why he chose these subjects to teach on? I don't believe it was just in response to what people were saying, because Jesus knew everything. He'd already prepared what he was going to say. I don't think he just reacted to questions rather than look for an opportunity to highlight vital subjects that we need also to consider, like the importance of fully understanding its authority. I know you might not know this, but authority is one of the biggest issues in the church today. And yet the difference it makes in our lives, and how easy it is for us to question his authority without even realizing it, especially when we challenge those he's put in authority. It's a challenge also to ensure that we're not trying to trap him like they trapped him in our resistance to do his will, because he always outsmarts us. He's smarter than you and me. We can come up with some pretty convincing arguments when we want him to agree to our will against his will. Anybody ever done that? No, I know you're all too good. You go on and on and on like a little kid. But God, you really know. You know how much I need this. And I can justify this because I really need this for this. And you know, I'll reach all these people if you give me this. And we have to understand the importance of giving and what true giving really is. It's the heart we give with, not just the amount we give out. And loving the Lord your God with everything you have, being totally committed and sold out to his purpose for your life. There's just a few thoughts. I don't have time to go into more and more, but there were so many subjects he covered just on one day, Tuesday. So then we move on to Spy Wednesday. Just in the name, it gives you a clue. I know you might not know what this is all about, but bear with me. First thing we need to know, very interesting. I didn't know this till I studied it. But it would appear from all accounts that Jesus took a day off. Think about it. It was a pretty stressful week, full of activity like throwing people out of temples, challenging those who were challenging him. And even Jesus needed a day off. But there were those, and especially someone, who didn't take a day off. In fact, he was very active this day. His name was Judas. This was the very night he agreed to betray Jesus. Spy Wednesday. It was the night he effectively signed the contract, went away and looked for an opportunity to do the dirty deed. Not a lot happened this day, really, in terms of what Jesus did, but in terms of what someone else did against Jesus, a lot happened. Just a few quick thoughts, because I want to get on to the last one. But a few thoughts. I think this is just a reminder of the importance of rest. And that shouldn't be Sunday, because Sunday isn't our day of rest. Sunday is our day of worship. I had to say that because I know that there will be some that will be going, exactly, Pastor, that's why I don't come to church, because I take a day of rest. No, we need to take a day of rest some other time. But it's important that Jesus illustrated to us, set an example of needing rest. Take some time out. Do some normal things. It doesn't have to be spiritual all the time. You don't have to justify your life with spiritual activities. Go out and do something that other people do. I think the other thing that challenges us is the challenge of whether you will stand by your commitment to Jesus, even if others close to you decide to betray him. There were other disciples that had to make that decision. I think they had an inkling that someone was doing something. They couldn't quite work out who, but they knew Judas. They knew that there was something not quite right about him, and maybe as the week transpired, they worked that out. But you know, at this point, they just had an inkling, and you have to decide when you get that inkling, are you going to be strong or are you going to get dragged down by the one that is weak? So here we are on Maundy Thursday. Around the table at the Passover meal, but again, Jesus, because he doesn't do anything in a conventional way, does something very, very different. During this meal, he set a precedent for what we should do to remember what he has done. And we too, in a few moments, are going to do something which is even more significant because we don't do it all the time in this setting. We do this in our Connect groups because we believe that in those settings, it's much more personal, it's much more intimate, it's much more meaningful. But today, we are going to take communion in this place. And we are going to do what they did, and we're going to remember what he did for us as we eat the bread, which symbolizes his body broken, and as we drink the wine, which symbolizes his blood shed. It was at this meal that he predicted that one would betray him and one would deny him. Now I want you to realize that these were two guys he trusted. It always impacts me because we too end up in this position in life and experience people who, like him, he thought he could trust. They were the closest to him. You couldn't get any closer to Jesus. And these were actually the very ones who destroyed that trust despite their promises and assurances. I'm sure I don't need to remind you, but Peter said, no way will I deny you. No way. I will swear on my life. And it says that very night, he went out and did it. It was at this meal that he also demonstrated real servanthood when he washed the disciples' feet. What an incredible display of servanthood, teaching us that it's better to serve than to be served. How the last will be first and the first will be last. I don't have the time to go into all of it, but so much was packed into so little time. And we really see why this week was the most significant week that Jesus ever lived. Why did he leave all of this for this week? It was also on this night when he was alone in the Garden of Gethsemane, the most agonizing night of his life. Even the Bible says he was deeply troubled and distressed. We're all human. We all have feelings. We all feel the betrayal of other people. We all feel what is happening in our lives. We all feel the things, but we have never felt what Jesus felt. This was the night that all of his disciples deserted him. Hang on. This is Jesus, who probably only just shortly before this, certainly the Sunday before, Palm Sunday, today, had crowds, had multitudes singing his praise. And now he's alone, agonizing, distressed, troubled, because no one is there for him. And the reality of what he was facing really impacted him. And for me, this is such an encouragement because it shows us this human side of Jesus, that even in his moments, he was deeply troubled and distressed. And he prayed a prayer that we probably prayed many, many times. Lord, take it away. Take away this situation. Take away the pain. Take away what I have to go through. I wonder whether we pray the next bit. But nevertheless, your will be done. Do we kind of stumble on that and we can't quite get those words out because we know what that means? We know we have to go through things because it is God's will for our life, because he has purpose in everything that we have to go through. There's so many thoughts that come to mind. Like, how often do we remember what he's done for us? Not just leaving it to communion today, but constantly being thankful every day of our lives. Developing an attitude of gratitude. Do you wake up in the morning grateful? Or do you wake up in the morning with your shopping list? Or do you wake up in the morning, rather than being grateful, grumpy? Some of you have to be honest right now because you've got someone next to you that's going to dig you. So you've just chosen the option of just staying silent. That's a good option to take. Silence is good. It's better than a dig in the side. Do we truly model real servanthood? Because that's what he was trying to show us. And finally, my last thought really is the importance of always being there in others' time of need. Jesus needed someone. In fact, he said, would you not just watch with me? Even just for one more hour. It says they were sleeping. There's a time to sleep, and there's a time to be awake. Think about some of the things that we've covered in this message. Praise, worship, humility, prosperity, victory, power, commitment, faithfulness, authority, servanthood, giving, gratitude. And that's just a few things. All of those things Jesus covered in that one week. And when you think about it, what else is relevant to our walk with God, and what else is required for building his church? Not much else. He packed it all into that week so that we might remember fresh what it's going to take to be a believer and to build his church.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.